Let's close our eyes for prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you very much for the privilege you've given us that will serve you and serve your people, lead the church, help the church to know who you are, to love you and to serve you and to be obedient to your word, and to prepare for fellowship with you here and fellowship with you in heaven. We pray, Lord, that we will not fail in the work you've committed into our hands, in Jesus' name. Help us to do this work as unto the Lord and not unto men, so that on that final day, when you examine the work of everyone, we'll receive reward from you. We pray, Lord, that we'll not lose our zeal, our passion, our fire for winning souls and getting people into the kingdom, so that when we appear before you, will not appear empty-handed. Speak to our hearts tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Since we finished our workers' retreat, we've been looking at series of subjects that are very, very important for anyone that really wants to serve the Lord acceptably. And tonight, I bring a passage of scripture that I discover many, many evangelical preachers do not understand. And it's been my privilege to have gone into this passage many, many years ago. And it was a time when an evangelical body in this country invited me to do a series on 1 Corinthians. And we had to go from chapter 1 and go through a lot of the chapters. And when we came to this chapter, we suddenly realized that many people have isolated some of the verses of this chapter. And you understand those isolated verses in isolation. And because they lack the connection, context of those verses, they really missed what the Lord was teaching the church. And I discovered to you that as I listen to some of us, and I see some of these verses are pulled out, and we read some of them in isolation, the things we say, the things we teach about those verses almost are not applicable to us as believers who are saved and who by the grace are living the normal Christian lives. But as we look at the passage today, I believe the Lord will open your eyes of understanding, so you will understand the word of God, and your understanding will help you to help the church minister in such a way that your service will have eternal rewards. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. Now, he that planteth and he that watereth are one, and every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry, ye are God's building. As you look at those two verses that introduce the verses we're looking at in chapter 3, you need to patiently examine the words of God and examine your heart. And then we allow the Spirit of God to reveal a motive for service, an actual service to the Lord, to reveal a motive to us. This is very necessary so that we and our converts will get to heaven and will be able to receive rewards for our labor and our service. We learned already last week as we looked at chapter 13 verses 1 to 3 that our service, no matter how great, no matter how sacrificial, no matter how supernatural, if it lacks love, it will not have any lasting value. That's the reason why we need to understand. It's not just a service by itself. It's not the preaching by itself. It's not the evangelistic activity by itself. It's not the running up and down by itself. It's not the money we spend on our outreaches by itself. And it is not the kind of zeal, the kind of fire, the kind of excitement, enthusiasm we put into the work by itself. It goes beyond the outward, superficial things that other people see. It goes very deep into the heart, because the Lord will find out how we do the work, why we do the work, what's our purpose, what's our reason for ministry. Tonight I'm talking to you on laboring for heaven and for eternal rewards. Laboring for heaven and for eternal rewards. What a purpose for which to labor. I've read to you already that as we labor, we're laborers, co-workers with the Lord. And he wants us to understand that the church is God's building. And as we get involved in the building, if we do it acceptably before the Lord, then he'll give us reward eternally. If not, we lose our reward. See, in John chapter 6 verse 27, labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you. For him has God the Father sealed. Here the Lord Jesus Christ told the people of his own day, and he's telling us, as it's written in the word, that we shouldn't labor for the things that perish. We shouldn't labor in such a way that at the end of the day, when Christ will come, when all men shall stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and everything we have done will be examined, then there'll be no reward. Everything perishes. It tells us to labor for things that will endure, that will last until eternity. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, 1 Corinthians 9, verse 24, know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize? So run that he may obtain. Here Paul the apostle was concerned, and then he brought in the life and the way the athletes run in the race. And he says, you see many of them running, and yet just one receives the prize. And then he brings it to the spiritual. He says, you so run in such a way that you will not run in vain. You'll be able to obtain eternal rewards. In Galatians chapter 2, verse 2. What Paul the apostle himself told others to do, he made sure he did. He examined his work. He examined his life. He examined his motive. He examined his doctrine. And he did that for a reason. You will know that Paul the apostle labored a lot and suffered a lot. And it was a concern of his heart that with all that labor, all the activities, everything, all the sacrifice he put into the service of the Lord, he didn't want to do all that in vain. And I call upon you to let's think, and you think for yourself, the daily activities, the sacrifices, the sweat and the labor, and the things you do, and you deny yourself of quite a lot of things, to find out at the end of the day that everything you've done, with all the self-denial, with all the sacrifice, all the sweat and the labor, to have run in vain. You cannot imagine how you will feel. Not only what you feel, what you will suffer throughout eternity. If everything that you have done passes through the fire of God's test
and everything is burnt up. And then you see everything you've done all through life, and then there's nothing to show for it in eternity. You'll be, of all men, the most miserable women to you, of all women, the most miserable. And that's the reason why, as we look at the passage we're studying, you want to look inward. You want to examine your service. You want to find out, what's the motive, the reason, the purpose for doing what I do? Sacrifice? Yes. Service? Yes. Sweat? Yes. What's underneath? In Galatians chapter 2, verse 2. And I went up by revelation and communicated unto them that gospel which I preach among the Gentiles. Paul the apostle said, you know, Galatians, you know what I did? After I preached for some time, I went. And I went to the people that were before me, the people that saw Jesus Christ face to face while here on earth. I wanted to communicate with them and tell them from A to Z all the things I've been teaching. I wanted them to examine me. We have said in chapter 1 that nobody taught him. He learned everything by revelation. And yet he said, I wanted to just be sure. Compare notes. And look at the race I'm running, the work I'm doing. Then he said, but privately to them, which were of reputation. He said, I went to those people, I know them. They are of reputation in the service of the Lord. They've been running this race before me. And I tabled everything before them. Why did I do that? Lest by enemies I should run or have run in vain. What a concern. That man was wise. That man was wise. You know, he ran and ran and ran. Then he stopped. He said, let me look back. And let me ask all these other people who have been in this business before I came in. Am I running all right? Am I doing it well? With your, you are with the Lord Jesus Christ when he was here on earth, with everything he told you and with the Spirit of God he gave you, because you experienced Pentecost before I ever came in, with the Spirit of God in your life and the knowledge of God that you possess. Look at me and look at my ministry. Let me bring my notes out and tell you everything I've been doing. Look at my notes. Am I running well? Because I don't want to run in vain. If I am wrong, while there is still life, there's privilege and opportunity to make correction. Paul the apostle, if a person like Paul could do that, how can we? Just keep on running, just keep on running, just keep on running without checking up what we do, how we're doing it, whether we're running in vain or we're going to have reward. Finally, come back to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Now we're going to look at verses 9 all through to verse 17. And we're going to divide the passage in three parts. Number one, the foundation laid by a dedicated minister. The foundation laid by a dedicated minister. Number two, the fire test for diverse ministries. The fire test for diverse ministries. Number three, the final end of defiling ministers. Ministers who defile. The final end of defiling ministers. Ministers who defile, not just defiling themselves, they defile the church. They defile the temple of God. They defile the body of Christ. Number one, the fountain. The foundation laid by a dedicated minister. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, chapter 3, verse 9. For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building, according to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder. I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For the foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Here Paul the apostle said, by the grace of God, by the leading of the Spirit, and by always examining himself, he says the Lord has called him to be a builder. Not just a builder, a master builder. What does he mean by that? A model builder. That other people who are building will be able to look at, and they'll be able to follow the pattern, the example, the model that this master builder, chief builder, has laid down. And how did he lay the foundation? He tells us there. He said, other foundation can no man lay than that which is already laid, Jesus Christ. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5. 2 Corinthians 4, 5. For we preach not ourselves. Take note of that. Take note of that. For we preach not ourselves. Take note of that. Don't stand between the people and Christ. Preach the word. Give them the word without any additives, any coloring, any chemicals, any sugar added to it. Anything that will lessen the sharpness of the edge of the sword. The word is sword. Don't add anything that will soothe, that will quench the fire in the word. The word is fire. Don't add any cushion that will lessen the impact of the hammer. The word is hammer. Don't add anything that will pollute the cleanliness of the water. The word is water. Don't add anything that will hinder the oppression of that word. When you give the word as it is, and you don't add your own experience, and I discover a lot of, I don't know why these people are so interested in going beyond the Bible. Especially when they begin to talk on, you know, all these evil spirits and mommy water spirit and water spirit and territorial spirit. And they paint a lot of colorful pictures until everybody almost has evil spirit. And they add this and add this and add this. Before you know what's happening, they're already beyond the territory of the world. And then they begin to tell us, you know, their experience. I was in such and such a place and this happened and this. And everything is just talking about themselves. Give them the word. There is nothing else that will save. There is nothing else that will turn men's lives around. It says, for we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus. And that's the foundation. What else are you going to preach? Jesus only. Jesus ever. Jesus all in all we sing. You know, many people don't understand why we sing that song every time. But it surprises me that we can sing that song for 1 year, 2 years. Nobody will be in this church 1 year and not sing that song. You attend Easter retreat. You attend December retreat. You attend workers' retreat. You attend Congress. You will sing it. Jesus only and Jesus ever. Jesus all in all will sing. Is our Savior. Is there any other name by which we can be saved? Is a healer. Is a sanctifier. Is a baptizer. And is the coming King. Why? Why do you sing such a song 15 years, 20 years, 30 years, and then when you begin to preach, you forget that Jesus only is a message. Therefore, Paul the apostle said, we preach not ourselves, we preach Jesus Christ, the Lord, and ourselves your servants, for Jesus' sake. And that's the thing we need to understand. And what Paul the apostle preached, a foundation he laid, was a foundation of Jesus Christ, and everything that Jesus taught in Colossians chapter 1, Colossians chapter 1, verse 25. Here he tells us, whereof I am made a minister, according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you, to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery, which has been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to the saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory, whom we preach, the Christ whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Said, that's our purpose, is to perfect every man, everyone that hears. That's the same thing the Lord is telling us, that we need to go back to the word and so emphasize the word and so preach the word. That's a lot. Look at the whole Bible. At the time you go from Genesis to, you know, Revelation, you have a lot to preach there. If you were to preach just one chapter of Genesis, you know, every week, it will take you 50 weeks, it will take you about a year. And if you were to preach, just stay in Matthew, and just go from chapter 1 to chapter 28, and you cannot finish every chapter in one sermon, it will take you almost a year or even more. There's a lot to preach in the Word, and everything is talking about Christ. And we should stay with that word instead of going beyond the word, going outside the word, and then getting yourself into condemnation. And then on the final day, there is no reward for what you have done, because you didn't speak the word of God the way it should be spoken. Preach the word. Acts chapter 20, in verse 20 and verse 21, and how I kept nothing that was profitable unto you, but I've showed you. And I've taught you publicly and from house to house, publicly and privately, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. He says, I didn't keep anything back from you. You know, if you don't have the right motive, you may know the word, you may know the verses, you will keep things away from the people of God because you have a private agenda. You have an ulterior motive. And then in verse 26, it says, wherefore I take you to record this day that I'm pure from the blood of all men. Why? For I have not shunned, I have not neglected to declare unto you all the counsel of God. All the counsel of God. And that's what we ought to do, just declaring all the counsel of God. I come to point number two, the fire test for diverse ministries. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, 1 Corinthians chapter 3, reading from verse 12. Now, if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire. And the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide which he has built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burnt, he shall suffer loss. But he himself shall be saved, so as by fire. Let's stop there for a moment. And that's the part that many, many people don't understand. I've listened to some evangelical people, and it's, that's talking about the believer. The believer who at one time raised up his hand, gave his life to the Lord. If that believer, that's what they say, lives right, has righteousness, is upright, walking with the Lord, they say that life, that Christian life, that's the gold and the silver and the precious stone. They say, but if that believer goes back to sin, is committing fornication, is having bitterness, is having hatred, is fighting, contention, strife, division, they say that's the wood, the hay, and the stubble. That when we eventually appear before the Lord on the day of judgment, that believer whose life has been full of sin. All those things will be burnt with fire. And that fellow, he will not have any reward, but he will get to heaven with sin, bitterness. Our brother was teaching at the time of building the body. He said that bitterness means that we are not sanctified. So we are saved with bitterness inside. We are saved with hatred inside. We are saved with the animosity and the malice inside. But that's what he says, we are not sanctified. So if you want to be sanctified, we will go to the Lord and tell him to take the bitterness away, the hatred away. And it says, he that hateth his brother walketh in darkness, and he stumbles, and he doesn't know where he's walking. Even some of us who are teaching here and teaching in our districts were misleading people, telling them that if they have this anger and fighting, quarreling, they are still saved, let them go and pray for sanctification. And he spoiled the whole thing. He said, when your heart is dirty, when you are not sanctified, then your language will be dirty. Out of the abundance of the earth, the mouth speaketh. And so, when somebody is not sanctified, that's our teacher's version, when somebody is not sanctified, the heart is dirty. And that's why you'll find lying, and you'll find all those things. So, according to him, let's teach our people, let's go and tell our people, get sanctified, get sanctified. Ah, my friend, if all those things are there, and you are dirty inside, you better go for salvation while there is still opportunity, while there's still chance. And we can be saved and know that there is a grace of God to walk in newness of life. Now, these people will teach us that you're a believer, you're still sinning. At the end of the day, when everything is burnt up, then you get to heaven. And the passage is not talking about ordinary believers. The passage is talking as a wise master builder, as a preacher, that's the apostle. That's somebody building upon this rock. I build my church. And that's a co-laborer with Christ. That's what he said. We are laborers with God. He's talking about preachers. Now he says, if the preacher is going to preach, let everyone that buildeth thereon take heed how he buildeth. Then he continues by saying, now, come on here. Here is the foundation. You come and build. What are you putting on the foundation? That's talking about preachers. Are you building gold? Are you building silver? Are you building precious stones? What are those? Permanent materials. Then he says, you come on here. What are you building? Are you building wood on the foundation? It's talking about preachers. Are you building stubble? Are you building hay? What are those? Perishable materials. Then he says, on that final day, our work will be tested, and will be tested by fire. If your work abides, then you receive reward. How will it abide? If you build gold, silver, precious stone. But you know he's talking about, it's actually using something physical to illustrate something spiritual. Therefore, we need to explain. What kinds of work, what kinds of service can we call gold, silver, precious stone? Number one, everything that you do only in the love of God. Everything, it may be small, it may be great, it may be for a day, it may be for a year. Everything that we do only in the love of God. For the love of Christ constraineth us. And we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead. You die to yourself and you go into that work of God and you do it without any thought of self. any thought about yourself, any thought about your gain, you do it purely for the love of God's sake. That's gold, silver, precious stone. Number two, ministry or evangelism that is done purely because you are consumed for the with the love of man. You love man so much that because you love him so much, you just want to do whatever you can do to get him into the kingdom of God. That's the gold, the silver, and the precious stone. That's why Paul the apostle said, I will gladly spend and be spent for you. Though the more abundantly I love you, the less I be loved. He said, you know what consumes me? It's the love of man. I love you so much, I cannot see you to be ignorant of the word of God. And when you are like that, that's the gold and the silver, the precious stone. Number three, work that is done for God's glory only. That's the gold. You come into the service of God, and everything you're doing it because you are jealous for the glory of God. You are consumed with the glory of God. The zeal of the Lord consumes you. You forget yourself. You even get yourself into danger doing the work of God. And you plunge on and you run on. And even when you know that there is danger, when you know that there are persecutions and oppositions, but you know this is going to tarnish the glory of the Almighty God. Because of your zeal for the glory of God, you rush into that thing. Like Jesus Christ, I seek not mine own glory. He that speaketh of himself seeketh his own glory. Like Paul the apostle, for neither at any time used we flattering words, as ye know, nor a cloak of covetousness, is God not the witness, nor of men sought we glory, neither of you nor yet of others. When you are consumed with the glory of God like that, and God looks at the work you are doing, that you are consumed, you are saturated just with the glory of God alone, that's the goal that he's talking about. Number four, work that's accomplished because you are driven and compelled by divine call and irresistible necessity. In your heart, you feel the call of God. The work sometimes is hard work, and it is, you know, it's something that demands everything that you have. It's like, you know, let me bring in some little history in the world. Winston Churchill in England, Second World War, he rallied all of England together, and then he used to have radio talk every day. He called all of England together and said, here, we're fighting for posterity. And he said, I want you to come join the army, and I promise you all I can promise you. I promise you sweat, tears, blood, death. Come on. Winston Churchill rallied all those people together, and because they wanted to save their country, even though all he promised them, blood, tears, sweat, death, everybody came. And it just took a few years, and you know, they finished, they were able to conquer Germany. You see, when you understand, you have a call, a divine call, and there is an irresistible necessity upon your life, and that is the thing that drives you. And then you say, for though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of, for necessity is laid upon me. Yea, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. If I do it willingly, I have a reward. But if against my will a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me, what's my reward then? Verily, that when I preach that gospel, I may make that gospel without charge, that I abuse not my power, not my privilege in the gospel. When you have that kind of a mind of Paul the apostle, and you just know that this is irresistible necessity laid upon you, and the Lord looks at you, and he knew the time you could have rested, the time when the going was hard, the time when everything was tough, and you needed to be on the firing line just to preach the gospel, uphold the standard. When you come on the last final day, and the Lord looks at your work, gold, silver, precious stone. Number five, ministry, arising from a great burden for others' salvation to the point of forgetting yourself. Ministry that arises from that great body of the salvation of others, to the point you forget yourself. That's why Paul said, I say the truth, in Christ I lie not. my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost that I have great, great, great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. For I could wish, think about this one, think about this, I could wish that I myself were accursed, cut away, separated from Christ. For my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. I'm telling you, when that man gets before the throne of God, and God looks at his work, and he saw that what consumed him was a burden to get people saved, even to the point of, if it were possible to separate him from Christ, that other people will come in, that's gold, that's silver, that's precious stone. Number six, ministry. Motivated by strong desire to prevent people from going to hell. Ministry that is motivated by strong desire to prevent people from going to hell. Not to have money, not to gather crowd, not offering, not to enrich ourselves, but the ministry that is motivated by strong desire just to prevent people from going to hell. It's like what was in the mind of that man speaking from hell, you know, comes on us. I pray you, Father Abraham, that thou wouldest send this Lazarus to my father's house. For I have five brethren there, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. That man was already in hell. But even though he was in hell, he had a concern that his five brothers back in the world should not come to that place of torment. When that same thing grips you and grabs you, and you see people like these in their teeming multitudes, you say, what can I do? You forget yourself. You are lost in your thoughts. What can I do that these people will not go to hell? When that is the thing that motivates you, you know, people come to me and, you know, they say they want to be missionary, they want to be this, they want to be that. Almost every time I counsel, there'll be a few people that will come, I want to do this, I want to. What's motivating them? Why? Is it because of wanting to be called a missionary, wanting position? But when it is something that is motivating, driving you, that you just can't bear the thought of people going to hell. Number seven, sacrificial service done to repay Christ's love in a measure. You are thinking, see what Christ has done for me. What can I do? What can I do so that I'll be able to repay in a measure what Christ has done for me? When that is the motive, the thing that drives you, compels you to get the work done, that's the gold, that's a silver. It's not a really particular service. It's not that, you know, whether it is apostleship or prophecy or being a missionary. It's not the, you know, categories like that, lining them up, gold, silver, precious stone. It's not talking of whether the preacher is better than the singer, whether the singer is better than the usher, whether the ushers are greater than the electronic people. That's not what he's saying. Anything you do for the glory of God, just because of that glory of God, it may even be sweeping the ground, sweeping, nobody else will do it, but you do it, you say, this will contribute a little part to show my love for what Christ has done for me. The gold, the silver, the precious stone. How about these other ones now? What kinds of service, what kinds of work? A wood, hay, stubble, that when the fire of God's examination comes on that thing, everything burns away. Number one, you know this, everything done without divine love. Everything done without divine love. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not charity, have not love, sounding brass, tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy, understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith that I could remove mountains, have not charity, nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and even give my body to be burnt, and have not love, charity, profits me nothing. Therefore, we know that all those things prophecy, knowledge, mystery, faith, casting out devils, without the divine love driving us. When you want to have a program, what do? You're planning and you're calculating. I'm going to have a program in that place. What's the reason? If it is not motivated by divine love, you may spend millions of naira and you may sweat until you almost die and collapse on the pulpit. If it is not motivated by divine love, on the final day, it's wood, hay, and stubble to be burnt up. Number two, every evangelistic activity or preaching that is done with envy and strife, they tell us that that other church that they had 20 million in one meeting over 1 week. I don't know how true that is, because the whole of Lagos is 8 million. To have 20 million in a place means you gather the whole of Lagos, you gather twice and half on top of it, 20 million in one meeting. I don't know how true that is, but there are some people that believe those figures. And so we then say, what are we doing? See, that other church, they have 20 million. So let us do this and we begin to plan. Is that not carnal competition? Is that the motivation for preaching? Is that the motivation for doing God's work? Every evangelistic activity or preaching that is done with strife and with envy. We envy them. See what they have got. What am I going to get? Some indeed preach Christ of envy and strife. That's wood, hay, stubble. It will be burnt with fire. Number three, every work that is done with contention and fighting. The one preach Christ of contention, not sincerely supposing to add affliction to my bonds. Number four, everything done with vainglory. Everything done seeking for the praise of men because of the love of praise. Everything done seeking honor from men. Everything done to be seen of men. Everything that is in the spirit of competition. Didn't the Bible tell us, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory? Nothing. Nothing. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. That's what condemned the Pharisees, for they loved the praise of men more than the praise of God. And that's what Jesus challenged those Pharisees with. How can you believe which receive honor one of another and seek not the honor that cometh from God only? And that's what he said in the Sermon on the Mount. Take heed that ye do not your arms before men to be seen of them. When all that we're doing, we want the people to praise us, to say, aha, so and so is like such and such. That's no more working for God. That's no more evangelism. It says, otherwise, ye have no reward of your Father which is in heaven. Number five, ministry of personal ambition. If you have ever read about one man in the Old Testament, it's called Jehu. He called Jonadab, Rechab. He said, come with me and see my zeal for the Lord. So they made him to ride in his chariot. Said, Jonadab, Rechab, the Rechabites, they praise you people that, you know, you're holding on to what your father taught you. You know I'm a zealous too. Come on, come on. Come into this chariot. Come and see what I'm going to do and see my zeal for the Lord. In that same chapter, the Bible says, but Jehu took no heed to walk in the law of the Lord God of Israel. He was too full of self, showmanship. That as, you know, just come and see what I can do, come and see what I can do. He forgot himself. And the Bible says, Jehu took no heed to walk in the Lord, in the law of the Lord God of Israel with all his heart. For he departed not from the sins of Jeroboam, which made Israel to sin. My brothers and sisters, this work is very delicate. You don't want to just labor for nothing. You don't just want to preach and preach and preach and be lost in the final end. Number six, everything that is done with pride, the pride of talent, the pride of achievement, the pride of accomplishment. See, I've arrived. Because it says, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace to the humble. Everyone that is proud in heart is abomination to the Lord. That's what the Bible says. Number seven, any ministry that is built on deception and false doctrine, that's wood, hay, and stubble. Any ministry built on deception. You know, that we have to campaign and we have to tell lies against other ministers, other preachers. Why do we have to do that? If you have a call of God and God wants you to evangelize, if it's truly the call of God, God will glorify himself. We don't have to tell lies against that other pastor, that other minister, before his members, so as to turn the mind of his members against him, and then steal his heart away like Absalom did, and join him to our new ministry. Why do we have to deceive people to build up a ministry? Is it business? Any ministry that you build on deception, on false doctrine, that's the wood, the hay, and the stubble. What reward are we going to get? For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs. Yes, signs may be there, and wonders, in so much that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. You know, there are some people that will have the attitude and say, deeper life is well taught, deeper life is solid. Leave those people alone if they want to deceive our people. Have we not taught them? They're all right. Deeper life is okay. Anybody wants to talk to our people, anybody wants to take our people, let them take them anywhere. No, we cannot let them take them anywhere. If possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Ah, one of the people that Jesus Christ himself taught still defected and went to the Sadducees and the Pharisees. You know, Paul, we're reading about him. Some of the people that Paul taught still went into false doctrine. That's why Jesus said, take it to yourself. And that's why, and of course it's my duty, if I know that anything will make you the elect of God to go astray, I have to, you know, stay by you and tell you that we've taught you the word of God. Stay by that word of God. Oh, because the Lord himself said, I'm sure you know this, if the watchman see the sword come and blow not the trumpet, and the people be not warned, if the sword come and take any person from among them, he is taken away in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at the watchman's hand. That's the reason I know the Lord has made me a watchman, not over Lagos, not over Nigeria, over you. And if I see the sword coming, and the sword is going to take you away, I'm not going to listen to people that, oh, don't worry about that. You know, deeper life people are well taught. If they go, they will come back. Some of them go, they never come back. I come to point number three, the final end of defiling ministers. That is, ministers that defile other people. Come back now to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in ye? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. For the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. Here is, you know, we take those verses and we apply it to the individual. You know, it's very common when we're talking to our boys, we say, you know, your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. When we're trying to prove to the sinner that smoking is not good, we tell that sinner, we say, you know what, you see this, your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. Think about that. Can that be right? The sinner, not born again, his body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. And then we tell him, when you smoke, you are defiling, destroying that body, the temple of the Holy Ghost, and God will destroy such a person. And we use that to convince them that smoking is wrong. And then after we are born again, we tell ourselves, now you know we are born again, and since we are born again, you know what? If we smoke, since our body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, it means we are defiling the temple of the Holy Ghost, and you know God will destroy us. The conclusion is true, but the scripture you are quoting, you quote it out of context. It's talking about ministers. It's talking about preachers. And it's saying, now, you, the Corinthian church, don't you know that together you are the temple of God? Because we, Ephesians chapter 2 now, we are the habitation of God. And then in verse 9 of this same chapter, he had said, ye are God's building, talking to all of them together as an entity. Now he says, the whole church of believers, that's the temple of God. And the Spirit of God dwells in you. Yes, dwells in you individually, dwells in you in the church. If any man, a minister now, a preacher now, defile the temple of God, him, that preacher, shall God destroy. That's the reason. In fact, sometimes when I preach, I wish that even people who are false teachers, false prophets, will listen to the cassette so that I can help them. All that we're preaching here, we're not preaching anything secret. We're telling everybody that the church is the body of Christ, is a temple of the Holy Ghost. That if any preacher, and if there's any preacher having false doctrine, having erroneous teaching, any preacher that is going to mislead believers, I even like the cases to be given to them. We're not preaching something that we say, don't tell them. No, we want you to tell them. If you come across them, and show them the scripture, say, my brother, come here. Let's sit down together. The body of Christ, the temple of the Holy Ghost. If any man, God is no respecter of persons. Whatever you preach, if you preach any false doctrine and a believer becomes careless because of your preaching and turns away from holiness and becomes defiled, my brother, I say to you in love, God says he will destroy you. That's why I'm warning you that you do not defile the temple of God. And if anybody comes to me and I know that he's not preaching the right thing, and he's going astray, that's exactly what I'm going to say. And the young man that is, you know, wanting to have crusade now in Lagos, that was in Deeper Life before, when I went to take over the work in New York, America, before going to Deeper Life Sunday morning, I first of all went to his new church. And I went to see him. And I saw him. They were having their Sunday school. I got to his office and I told him, I said, I told you before, you said God is calling you. If God is calling you, that's the reason you say you are now here. All right. Then I said, please remember this word. Don't deviate from this word. Stick to the word. If it's a call of God, all right. Then I said, if you are not able to do it, or if, the other way I say this other way, that if God now tells you, come back here, that I'm open. The door is open, come back. When he was with ministers of Deeper Life, all of them, I spoke to them from Lagos here, and they put it on speakerphone. Everybody had said, Thank you very much. We've been in fellowship together all these years. Now you say God is calling you. Then I said, everybody heard, he heard, and he told me later. Now when I was talking to him on the phone, that he was shaking, holding somebody, because he didn't know that I'll be that straight. I said, please, remember Laban and Jacob. They put the stone here, and Laban said, Jacob, you will not cross this stone to come and hurt me, and I will not cross this stone to come and hurt you. I said, remember, as you say you are going, God has called you. Don't come over here. You know what I've been teaching. You know the word of God. You know my very life. Don't do anything, say anything that I will hear. And then you cross over this stone of covenant to hurt me. You know, when I preach, when I say what I need to say, I say it clear to everybody and they can hear. And now, if such a person, and he promised me, he said, thank you, sir. People don't know. He didn't know I could do that. And then I released him. And of course, I need to be going there now. The people that remain there, they say they are still deep alive. Since they don't have overseer, I have to go there and encourage, edify, build up the people remaining there. If not, I will answer for them. Because he that knows to do good and does not do it to him, it is sin. Therefore, I have to go there, help the people, and, you know, rake things together again. That's how I'm going. I'm doing what I'm. It's not easy running up and down. And if the young man now, it's not 6 months yet, and he promised me he will not hurt me. And some of the key people I have here, brainwashing them, hooking them, snatching them away. That's not what we agreed. And when his people come to my meetings in New York, and I know them, those who have gone with him, you'll be surprised. I just greet them and shake their hands. I control myself not to even invite them back to Deep Alive, even though they were Deep Alive before. See, the way I've kept my own part of the covenant, that I will not hurt you. And then, you know, somebody then will now cross over here and destroy this one. This church will not be destroyed. Because if any man, no matter, even Moses, anybody, anywhere, this work that is built upon unshakable rock, this one is built on the Bible. Look at it. There's no secret, there's no hanky-panky here. This is a church built on the rock of ages. The gates of hell cannot prevail against it. And I'm calling upon you. You are my brothers and sisters. And I'm telling you, if you love the Lord and you love righteousness, you want to stand upon this world. And you know, when I see people like you, that you are standing, that you love the Lord, sometimes I shout on you, sometimes I, you know the way I talk, but I'm sure you know why I talk the way I talk. And when I see you the way you are, and I come in here, I see you're still there, just seeing you alone, I know that my labor is not in vain. I'm praying that you'll keep on standing. Now, before we pray, I'm going to ask you a question. Psalm 94 verse 16. Look at it. Who will rise up for me against the evildoers? Or who shall stand up for me against the workers of iniquity? Anybody